Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the dates 4th and 5th of August 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Trivandrum editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis will be available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. This news article discusses about the repo rate and their role in the growth of the economy. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Let us now see the article. This article tells that the Monetary Policy Committee has lowered the repo rate to 5.75% in the Monetary Policy Review meeting which was held in the month of June. Now, let us see about this Monetary Policy Committee. Know that the central government has constituted a 6-member Monetary Policy Committee, which is as per Section 45ZB of the Reserve Bank of India Act of 1934. So, out of these 6 members, 3 members are from RBI, that is the Reserve Bank of India, and 3 members are nominated by the central government. And this Monetary Policy Committee is headed by the Governor of RBI. So, the Governor of RBI is the chairperson of Monetary Policy Committee. Now, this Monetary Policy Committee fixes the policy interest rates in order to achieve the inflation targets. Also know that as per this Reserve Bank of India Act of 1934, the Monetary Policy Committee is required to meet at least 4 times in a year. But if you see, it usually meets once in 2 months, and once in every 2 months, they review the policy rates. So, if you see in the months of February, April and June in this year, that is 2019, each time the Reserve Bank of India, that is the Monetary Policy Committee, has cut the policy repo rate by 25 basis points. Now, 25 basis points means 0.25%, and when we tell 100 basis points, it is 1%. So, since February, 75 basis points have been cut so far, so it is 0.75%. Now, despite cutting the rates, the news article tells that the economy, that is the Indian economy, has failed to grow. There is no growth in Indian economy. And also it is expected that the Monetary Policy Committee will reduce the policy repo rate when it meets this month as well, that is in the month of August. Now, let us see what is meant by this policy repo rate. Simply, if you see, it is also called as repo rates. The commercial banks will borrow some money from the Central Bank of India, which is nothing but the Reserve Bank of India. The interest rate which the commercial banks have to pay to the Reserve Bank for this borrowing is called as the repo rate. Now, paying means it is not just that the bank would pay only money to the Reserve Bank of India. They mortgage the government securities and also the treasury bills that they have with them. So, it is similar to like how we mortgage our homes in order to get some loan from the commercial banks. Now, if the repo rate is reduced by the Reserve Bank of India, that is the Monetary Policy Committee, the banks will have 2 options. First is, the banks will increase the borrowing from the Reserve Bank since the rates have become low now. So, if the banks are borrowing higher amounts from the Reserve Bank, the credit creating capacity of banks will increase because it is having more money now. Secondly, the commercial banks will have to pass on the rate cut benefits to its customers. Nothing but the borrowers who borrow the money from these commercial banks. Now, if you see for example, the policy repo rate cut is 5.75% and the bank rates have to be adjusted to 5.75% ideally. So, the banks have to lend money to the customers at an interest rate of 5.75%. So, if the interest rates are lower and attractive, the customers and the businesses will borrow more money. So, they have more money now, and we can tell that the money supply in the economy is more. Or we can also tell that there is a high liquidity in the market. So, remember these terms, money supply or high liquidity. Now, if the repo rate is increased, the banks have 2 options. Either to reduce the borrowing from RBI or borrow at higher rate from the Reserve Bank and pass it on to the bank customers by charging them higher rates. So, in both these scenarios, you can see that the commercial banks have 2 options. One is to increase or decrease their borrowing from the Reserve Bank of India. The second option is to pass on the interest rates to the bank customers. That is nothing but the borrowers. So this is what we call it as transmission of rates. Usually, if you see, the commercial banks will pass on the burden to the borrowers who borrow money from the bank whenever there is an increase in the policy repo rate. And whenever there is a decrease in the policy repo rate, the commercial banks usually do not pass on the whole interest rate cut. For example, if you see, the repo rate is reduced from 6% to 5.75%, which means a reduction of 25 basis points or 0.25%. So the commercial banks will have to pass on this 25 basis points reduction to the borrowers. Instead, if you see, the banks will not pass on this rate cut. They will just reduce only 5 basis points or 10 basis points. We saw that totally the Monetary Policy Committee had reduced 75 basis points in the last 3 meetings in this year, 2019. In this news article, it is mentioned that as per the Reserve Bank of India's assessment, only 21 out of the 75 basis points have been passed on to the borrowers by the banks. So we can see that the commercial banks are not ready to pass on the benefits to the borrowers. Instead, they will just pass on the burden to the borrowers. This is also one reason why the Monetary Policy Committee might again go for a policy repo rate cut, because there is no proper transmission of rate cuts. Next, let us see what is meant by reverse repo rate. The commercial banks would deposit some money with RBI and they would get some interest for the money which they have deposited with RBI. Now, this rate is called as a reverse repo rate. Now, let us see why the Indian commercial banks are not ready to immediately pass on the rate cuts of RBI to the consumers. The main reason which this news article tells is the deposits. If you see, the deposit rates have remained high. Now, take an example. Suppose you have 1000 rupees. And you deposit that 1000 rupees in the commercial bank for 1 year. The bank will pay an interest rate for the deposit that you have made. This is what is called as a deposit rate. Now, apart from the money that the commercial banks borrow from the central bank, that is the RBI, they also get some money in the form of deposits. So, with this money, the commercial banks are able to give money to the borrowers. The news article tells that the deposit rates have remained high in India for two reasons. The first reason is that the interest rates in the government's small savings schemes have remained high. If you take, for example, the deposit rates of State Bank of India is just 6.8%. But at the same time, the deposit rates of Public Provident Fund and the National Savings Certificate are 7.9%. It means that for every 100 rupee you deposit, you are likely to get an interest of 6.8 rupees from the State Bank of India and 7.9 rupees as interest from these two, the Public Provident Fund and the National Savings Certificate. So, ideally, any person will think to invest her or his money in the Public Provident Fund and the National Savings Certificate, since the interest rates are quite high. Now, just consider this as one example. So, if you see, the commercial banks like SBI are not in a position to cut their deposit rate. The other reason why the deposit rates have remained high is because of the liquidity crunch. When we tell liquidity, it is something about the liquid money, that is the money supply. So, liquidity crunch means shortage in the money supply. If you see, this liquidity crunch happened because the non-banking financial company IL&FS was not able to pay back loans since September 2018. So, you can tell that there was no money within the system. Now, in order to get money, one way is to keep the deposit rates high, since more people will start to deposit if the deposit rates are high. The news article tells that the liquidity position has improved now due to the intervention of the Reserve Bank of India. That is, RBI has taken some actions to improve the liquidity. Now, the point that you need to note here is that the commercial banks have to make sure that they keep getting continuous deposits from the citizens, or say the individuals, so that they have enough money in order to lend to the borrowers or businesses. Since banks are not in a position to lose the money that they receive through the way of deposits, they keep the deposit rates also high and also the lending rates also high. So, this is the reason why the commercial banks do not pass on the benefits of rate cuts to the borrowers. So, this is how it is linked. But if you see, the deposits are likely to increase now since the liquidity has increased now and more people will start to deposit more money in the banks. So, the banks are also likely to get more money. Hence, the news article tells that it is now time for the commercial banks to pass on the benefit of lower interest rates, that is the lower repo rates to the borrowers, which means the transmission of rate cuts should be proper. Next, let us see about the government's point of view and the central bank's point of view with regard to the repo rates or the interest rates, as it is called generally. We saw that the Central Bank of India is the Reserve Bank of India. So just keep this in mind. And we also saw that whenever the interest rates are lower, then the borrowers or the businesses will try to get more money from the banks. So the investments in the businesses will increase, and this will lead to more job creation. And finally, it would result in the higher growth. So the news article tells that any government will support only lower interest rates, because if there are higher interest rates for borrowing the money, then the overall project cost would go up, and this would also reduce the investments. But if you see the central banks of the countries, if you see the Reserve Bank in case of India, they all think otherwise. For them, targeting the inflation is a major problem. Now, when the interest rates are lower, it means that the money is easily available to the individuals. That is, the liquidity is more. And when there is more money, the individuals will automatically start purchasing more goods and more services. And when they start purchasing more, the demand for the goods and the services automatically rises. So this will lead to inflation or the rise in the value of the goods and services. Nothing but the price rise. So the central banks will always try to maintain a fine balance with respect to maintaining the interest rates. Mostly, if you see, the interest rates will be on the higher side, that is fixed by these central banks. In the news article, it is mentioned that the former United States President George W. Bush lost to Bill Clinton in 1992 US presidential elections because the then chairman of the Central Bank of USA, which is the Federal Reserve, did not lower the interest rates since he was very much concerned about inflation. But the outgoing President George H.W. Bush said that if the interest rates had been lowered, then the US economy would have recovered and his government would have sustained. So you can see both the arguments of the government and also the central bank seem to be genuine from their point of view. But if you see, the government of the day typically has a short-term view when it comes to the growth of the economy, because for them, their political interests are higher rather than the view towards the economy, because the government keeps changing and also the priorities of the government keep changing. But the central banks usually have a long-term view. So they think that low inflation would eventually lead to higher growth in the future. The news article has also mentioned an example from India where the then Union Finance Minister under UPA 2 government had pushed for cuts in the interest rates. But the then RBI Governor Duvuri Subbarao insisted on higher rates in order to keep the money supply and the inflation in the lower level. The RBI governor had told that to experience a sustained high growth, a low inflation scenario is a prerequisite. So just remember, when we mean by the term interest rates with respect to the central banks in the context of this news article, it means the repo rate. The news article also tells that the fiscal deficit of the government has to be considered while fixing the repo rates. So let us now see the link between the fiscal deficit versus repo rates. Now, fiscal deficit means the government spending or expenditure is more than the revenue that it receives. If the fiscal deficit is more, then the government is spending more, which means the inflation in the market will be high. So, the central banks always try to keep the interest rates high in order to control the inflation. Next, the news article discusses if only lowering the repo rates are enough to make the economy grow. The news article has mentioned that there are three factors of production if any company, that is if any commercial entity wants to grow. The first factor of production is the capital, nothing but the money. But only with capital, we cannot tell that a company can survive. Along with capital, we also need other two factors of production, which are the land and the labor. But if you see, the land will be generally costly to acquire and set up an industry and operate it. So the news article is telling that the local governments have to provide lands to the businesses at cheaper costs so that the industries can be set up and run. The third factor of production is the labor. If you see, the labor is adequately available in India, but the availability of skilled labor is a challenge. So consider that the businesses have all the factors of production and they manufacture goods and services. But if the people are not getting enough money in hand as salaries, then the liquidity will be less in the market. That is, the money supply will be less in the market. So there will not be any demand in the market to purchase the goods and services that are produced. So there should be a demand in the market to purchase the goods and services. So production also should happen at one side, and the other side, the demand should also be there. So the news article tells that the government should work on stimulating the demand, and the RBI should jointly work on keeping the interest rates low so that the economy will grow. So it should be a joint effort by both the government and the central bank, in this case the Reserve Bank of India. So the news article is telling that rate cut in the upcoming monetary policy announcement this week has to be supported with some positive measures from the government side. Only a rate cut will not help in reviving the economic activity. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article discusses about deep sea mining and its potentials. The syllabus with which the analysis of this news article can be linked is given here for your reference. Let us now see the news article. The Union Ministry of Earth Sciences has announced that India's ambitious deep ocean mission is all set to be launched this year. If you see, this is an 8,000 crore deep sea mining plan. So they are planning to explore the deep sea minerals in the Indian Ocean region. According to the International Union for Conservation of Nature, deep sea mining means the process of extracting mineral deposits from the area in the ocean below 200 meters. So it is the mining which is done below the epipelagic zone. If you see, this epipelagic zone is the surface layer of the oceans that extends from the surface layer, that is the upper surface of the water, till the 200 meters depth. Take this word epipelagic. Epi means over or upon, and pelagic means open seas. So the upon the open seas. So it directly means that epipelagic means. Now let us have a brief discussion on the ocean floor. So what will be in the ocean, under the ocean? First is the continental shelf. So this is a gradually sloping area from the border of each continent, and the width of this continental shelf can vary from few kilometers, and it can also stretch up to 1300 kilometers from the shore. Next, there will be a steady inclination. So this will be the continental slope. From the continental shelf, there will be a steady inclination downwards. This is called as continental slope. Next is the sea mounts. Sea mounts are nothing but the mountains under the oceans whose peak will not break onto the surface of the oceans. That is, you cannot see the peaks of such sea mounts above the water level. If you see, sea mounts are located at a depth of 800 to 2500 meter. Next is the abyssal plains. The abyssal plains are the vast flat plains that are formed by thick sediments, and also which are formed because of the dead organism. Now, if you see, these abyssal plains are found at a depth of 4000 to 6000 meters. Next is the hydrothermal vent. It is an opening in the sea floor through which the geothermally heated mineral rich water rises. If you see, they are roughly found around a depth of 1000 to 4000 meters. So this is all about the ocean floor, which you need to know. Now, let us see what are the potential deep sea spots for mining. If you see, ferromanganese nodules are found on the ocean bed or abyssal plain at a depth of 4000 to 6000 meters. Then at sea mounts, which are located at a depth of 800 to 2005 meters, we can find the metal rich crusts. Then sulfur deposits are found near the hydrothermal vents. And the sediments which are surrounding the hydrothermal vents are mineral rich rocks. Next, let us see about polymetallic nodules and the potential of these polymetallic nodules. Now, what is meant by polymetallic nodules? They are small rounded accretions which are composed of minerals like manganese, nickel, cobalt, copper, and iron hydroxide. When we tell by the word accretions, they tend to accumulate layer on layer, layer on layer. So this is what you mean by accretions. If you see, the size varies from few millimeters to centimeters. And in the Indian Ocean floor, they lie scattered at depths of 6000 meters, and they are also identified in the Central Pacific Ocean. This region is called as the Clarion-Clipperton Zone. So we can extract metals from these polymetallic nodules, and we can use them in the manufacturing of electronic devices, smartphones, batteries, and also in the solar panels. Now, in this central Indian Ocean basin, huge amounts of polymetallic nodule resource can be found. Totally, if you see, around 380 million tons of polymetallic nodules have been estimated, which also includes 4.7 million ton of nickel, 4.29 million ton of copper, then 0.55 million ton of cobalt and 92.59 million ton of manganese. So you can see that the quantity of manganese is more amongst these polymetallic nodules. So the mining area is roughly around 18,000 square kilometer, and it is called the first generation mine site. So where will the team mine and who is the authority? The authority is the International Seabed Authority. This International Seabed Authority allots the area for deep sea mining. If you see, in the year 1987, India was the first country to receive the status of a pioneer investor by the International Seabed Authority. It also allowed India an area of around 1.5 lakh square kilometer in the Central Indian Ocean Basin for exploring the polymetallic nodules. And in the year 2002, after a complete resource analysis of seabed, India retained an area of 75,000 square kilometer for mining these polymetallic nodules. Now let us see in short about International Seabed Authority. It is an intergovernmental organization which is established under the 1982 United Nations Convention on the Law of the Seas, in short UN clause. If you see, this International Seabed Authority regulates the exploration and exploitation of marine non-living resources of oceans in the international waters. This authority was formed in the year 1994, and the headquarters is located at Kingston, Jamaica. Now let us see how this mining of deep sea polymetallic nodules is done. There is a riser pipe and a seafloor collector. So both these will be used to transfer the nodules into the mining ship, and in the return pipe from the ship, whatever remaining rock debris are there, they'll be transferred through the return pipe back to the sea floor. Now, when will India start mining? India is expected to start its mining operations by October 2019, that is within 2 months. According to the National Institute of Ocean Technology, which is located in Chennai, they have developed and demonstrated a mining technology with artificial nodules at 500 meters depth, and then they have also deployed a remotely operated vehicle and in situ soil tester at a depth of 6000 meters. In situ means in that place. If you see, India's mining site is at about a depth of 5500 meters with high pressure and extremely low temperature. It means the area where we are going to mine, there will be high pressure and the temperatures will be extremely low. So the newly developed machine for 6000 meters will soon be deployed in these 5500 meters for mining. Next, let us see which are the other countries which are in the race to mine in the deep sea. If you see, the International Seabed Authority has entered into 15-year contracts for exploration of polymetallic nodules, polymetallic sulfides, and cobalt-rich ferromanganese crusts in the deep seabed with 29 contractors. So countries such as China, Russia, South Korea, Japan, France, Germany, Cook Islands, and then Kiribati have all joined this race. So they have tested their technologies in the shallow waters, and they are yet to start their deep sea operations. Next, let us see if this deep sea mining is economically viable. The International Seabed Authority estimates that the deep sea mining will be commercially viable only if about 3 million tons are mined per year. Now, let us see what will be the environmental impact. The deep sea's ecology and biodiversity because of these mining remains poorly understood. So it is very much difficult to assess the environmental impact. So it also makes framing of the guidelines very much difficult. According to International Union for Conservation of Nature, these deep and remote locations can be home to unique marine species. So if you see, they could have been well adapted to conditions such as poor sunlight and oxygen, and they can even survive at high pressure and extremely low temperatures. And we do not know many of these marine creatures which are living in the deep. So when we are going to do deep sea mining, they are likely to go extinct even before they are known to the world. So these might be the possible environmental impacts because of deep sea mining. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article talks about the potential of canine distemper virus to spread from dogs which are living near the wildlife sanctuaries to those tigers which live in these wildlife sanctuaries. Now, the syllabus which is relevant to the analysis of this news article is displayed here for your reference. If you see, on International Tigers Day, that is on 29th of July 2019, the Prime Minister of India had released the results of All India Tiger Estimation 2018. And it is said that between 2014 and 18, in this report, the tiger population in India has increased by 33%. So the total number of tigers in India is now at 2,967. Now, if you see, the survival of tigers in India have long been threatened by their loss of habitat, then the decline of the prey, that is the animals which they consume for their food, and also because of poaching. But if you see, a new threat has emerged, which is a new virus, and this virus name is called as the canine distemper virus. If you see, this canine distemper virus is a contagious and a serious disease which is caused by the virus. So this virus attacks the respiratory system, gastrointestinal system, then the nervous systems of the dogs, and it can spread through direct contact or even through indirect contact. The primary method of getting this infection is by inhaling the virus, and there is no effective cure which is known for this canine distemper virus. It is seen that the virus has been transmitted to the tigers from those dogs that are infected by this canine distemper virus, and these dogs which are living in and around the wildlife sanctuaries. A group of researchers have conducted a study around the villages near the Ranthambore National Park in the state of Rajasthan. If you see, the researchers have studied the blood samples for over 100 dogs that are living near this national park, and the results showed that 86% of the dogs were tested positive for this canine distemper virus in their blood. So this means that the dogs are either currently infected or they would have been infected sometime in their life, and they would have overcome this canine distemper virus disease. So this shows that there is an increased risk of disease transfer from these dogs to the tigers and also the leopards that live in this park, because these dogs wander into the forest along with the humans, and there have also been cases where the leopards have hunted these dogs. So the virus would have transmitted from the dogs to the leopards, and this virus can also spread through air through the infected animals, either through sneeze or through cough. Last year, if you see, in the Gir forest in the state of Gujarat, over 20 lions died because of this canine distemper virus infection. Now, the National Tiger Conservation Authority has formed a guideline to prevent the spillover of the disease to the wild animals. That is, they want to make sure that the virus is not transmitted from the domesticated animals like dogs to the wild animals. And there have also been some studies that were carried out in Russia and Africa, and they've all shown that the small isolated wildlife populations are more susceptible to the virus. Because if you see, in Gir forest, the lions are isolated only to the Gir forest area, and say if the canine distemper virus attacks all these lions, the entire population of the lions will die and they can even become extinct. So this is the biggest problem of this canine distemper virus infection. Now let us see what are the steps that needs to be taken in order to prevent this canine distemper virus infection. First of all, the role of domestic animals as the canine distemper virus reservoirs should be understood. When we tell canine distemper virus reservoirs, they are nothing but these animals act as hosts for these canine distemper virus. So the main aim should be to vaccinate the free-ranging and domestic dogs around these national parks. Free-ranging means they just roam around freely around the fringes of the national park, and suppose, say, when a wild animal comes and attacks these dogs, then there are chances that the wild animals will acquire this canine distemper virus infection. So several NGOs have started animal birth control programs, so the government should also support the NGOs in this initiative. Then more focus should be given on this canine distemper virus infection. If you see, right now there is no countrywide data of these canine distemper virus cases, so it should be collected and studied in detail in order to know about these canine distemper virus infection. So this will help to identify the vulnerable animals, the hot spots where there are more chances of outbreak of this canine distemper virus. So this would help to make preventive guidelines in the future. If you see, the canine distemper virus does not have a cure till now. So the only and the most effective way is the prevention of this canine distemper virus. If you see, it is extremely difficult to manage the diseases in wildlife. So the government should take steps to vaccinate the dogs which are roaming around the wildlife sanctuary. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This editorial discusses about the recent increase in the strength of the judges in the Supreme Court. And the author of this editorial has also mentioned some other suggestions for the smooth functioning of the Supreme Court. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Let us now see the editorial. The Union Cabinet has decided to raise the strength of the Supreme Court judges from 31 to 34. This also includes Chief Justice of India. If you see, as on 11th July, the number of pending cases in the Supreme Court is 59,331. So increasing the strength of Supreme Court will help in clearing the huge number of pending cases. If you see, as per the last amendment which was made to the Supreme Court Number of Judges Act 1956, the strength of the Supreme Court judges was increased from 26 to 31, and this number also includes the Chief Justice of India. And now the cabinet has decided to further increase this 31 to 34, which also includes Chief Justice of India. In the editorial, the author has told that the present Chief Justice of India, Mr. Ranjan Gogoi, had written to Prime Minister recently on highlighting the problem of low strength or the less number of judges in the Supreme Court. And because of this, the Chief Justice of India has told that he was not able to constitute enough constitution benches in order to interpret constitution or laws. The author tells that there is an unnecessary burden on the Supreme Court because it has to deal bail related cases, then public interest cases, then even some judgments of High Court that are appealed in Supreme Court. The author tells that just by increasing the court strength, the pending cases are not going to decrease. So the author has proposed some suggestions to save the work burden of the Supreme Court. He has suggested that there should be reasonable restrictions on the timing of the oral arguments that are made in a particular case in the Supreme Court. Also, if you see, the schedule of the hearing time of cases also should be correctly followed as per the schedule. So these both are the suggestions that has been given by the author. Next, the author is suggesting that the primary role of the Supreme Court must be preserved. He tells that the primary role of the Supreme Court is that it should be the ultimate arbiter. That is, the Supreme Court must be the ultimate arbiter or the final authority in interpreting the Constitution of India and also the statutes or the laws of India. So all the other questions involving a final decision on routine matters, like for example the civil cases where only two parties are involved, has to be separately dealt with a special mechanism in place. The author has told that some countries have brought in a clear division at the level of apex judiciary, like having separate constitutional courts. And these constitutional courts limit themselves to deciding questions of constitutional importance. So similar to this practice, the author is suggesting that Indian government should try to implement the 229th report of Law Commission. Know that this report was submitted by the Law Commission in the year 2009. This report suggested for the division of the Supreme Court, that is, dividing the Supreme Court based on various functions that the Supreme Court does. So this 229th report suggested that there should be one constitutional bench which is located at New Delhi, and there should be four cassation benches in four different regions of India. It proposed that the four cassation benches be located at Delhi for the northern zone, then at either Chennai or Hyderabad for the southern zone, then at Kolkata for the eastern zone, and at Mumbai for the western zone. So these four cassation benches will deal with appeals from a high court in that particular region. They will deal with routine litigation activities, that is, they will deal with the normal cases. So the number of pending cases will also be broadened. Now, there is one more advantage for having cassation benches in the four different regions, because it will increase the access to justice. Now, how will it increase the access to justice? For example, you take a person is located at Chennai and the main constitutional bench is located at Delhi. So he has to travel all the way from the southern part of the country till Delhi in order to get justice. Now, say if a bench is located either at Chennai or Hyderabad in the southern zone, then the access to justice will be easier, and this timing and money and everything would be saved in getting access to justice. So this is one advantage of having cassation benches in the four different regions of India. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this editorial. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article speaks about the scanning of 20,000 genomes for cancer study. The syllabus which is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Let us now see the news article. The Department of Biotechnology, which comes under the Ministry of Science and Technology, has planned to scan nearly 20,000 Indian genome under the Genome India Initiative program. So this is planned over 5 years in two phases. And this project is expected to develop diagnostic tests that can be used for cancer. Diagnostic means to know a particular disease. First, let us understand what genome is. If you see, the genome of an organism is nothing but the complete set of its genes. And genes of humans are made up of DNAs, that is deoxyribonucleic acid. Genome sequencing is figuring out the order of the DNA nucleotides or bases in a genome, that is the order of adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine. All these four make up an organism's DNA. In the first phase of the project, genomes of nearly 10,000 Indians will be sequenced. So this will help to capture the biological diversity of India. And in the second phase, another 10,000 genomes of deceased individuals would be sequenced. So these two different sets of data would be compared using machine learning. So this will help to identify the genes that can predict cancer risk, as well as other diseases that could be influenced by any other genetic anomalies, that is any other genetic issues. Now, it is to be noted that machine learning is an application of artificial intelligence, and this machine learning provides the systems the ability to automatically learn and improve. So it will focus on developing computer programs, and these programs can access data and use it for themselves to learn. Now, this Genome India Initiative program involves 22 institutions from the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research and from the Department of Biotechnology. The data that is generated would be accessible to researchers anywhere, and the data would be made available through the National Biological Data Center, which has been planned as per the Biological Data Storage Access and Sharing Policy. Now, know about this Biological Data Storage Access and Sharing Policy. It is a policy that deals with the storage, accessibility and sharing of data that is generated using biotechnological methods. And it is under the Department of Science and Technology. Now, if you see, this policy is in its early stages of discussion. Now, according to the Department of Biotechnology, the first phase would start in October 2019 and the estimated budget for this program is 250 to 350 crores. Now, as a part of this program, the samples of microbiome from the human gut would be collected by the National Center for Cell Sciences. Know that this National Center for Cell Sciences is located in Pune, Maharashtra. One thing which we need to know is about the human microbiota. This human microbiota is made up of trillions of cells, which also includes your bacteria, viruses and fungi. The biggest collection of these microbial cells can be found in the human gut or the stomach, then in the skin and also in the genitals. The microbiome is the name given to all of the genes in these cells. Now, why do we need to know about microbiota? Because it is important for nutrition and immunity of an individual. Even a small disturbance in their relationship, that is the relationship between the microbes, can cause diseases. So the scientists around the world are intensely studying the intimate connection between the genome, the gut microbiome and the diseases. Now, let us discuss about the importance of genome sequencing. Now, whatever data that is collected through genome sequencing will help us to develop genome-based diagnostics. And this could be affordably delivered through the labs. So once we have the entire data, the health solutions will become affordable. That is very cheap, and anybody can have access to affordable diagnostic healthcare with the help of genome sequencing. Next, the Genome India project will cover the biological diversity in India. This database would be of immense help for the researchers to analyze the reasons for the prevalence of diseases in a particular region or even among a particular group, etc. Then the genes that can predict cancer risk and genetic anomalies that can cause several diseases can also be effectively studied. So this would lead to a revolution in the field of human health. If you see, certain diseases like thalassemia, which is an inherited blood disorder characterized by less hemoglobin in the blood, they are all the result of single gene malfunction. That is, single gene in the human body would malfunction. That is, they will not function as per their normal function. And because of this, there will be less hemoglobin in the blood. And because of this, thalassemia might occur. Now, with the help of genome sequencing, it will be very easy for us to identify those particular genes which malfunction. So, this is how genome sequencing will help in the healthcare industry. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article speaks about the status of Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin in the state of Madhya Pradesh. The syllabus with which the analysis of this news article can be linked is given here for your reference. The news article tells that the state of Madhya Pradesh has surrendered more than a quarter of its allotted houses for this financial year under the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin scheme. If you see, the annual action plan had allocated a target of 8.32 lakh houses for this financial year to Madhya Pradesh, and out of this, the state has surrendered 2.32 lakh houses. The reason which it told was that it was not able to meet the target because it is believed that the loan waiver scheme of Madhya Pradesh has put a lot of financial burden on its state budget. So the state was not able to meet its annual target under this Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin scheme. According to Union Ministry of Rural Development, it is said that this was the first time that any state has done so by telling that it was not able to meet the target. Now, let us focus on the important provisions of Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin. If you see, already there was a rural housing scheme called as Indira Awas Yojana. That particular scheme has been restructured into Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin. Here, Gramin means villages. This scheme aims to provide every rural Indian family a pakka house, that is a well-built house with basic amenities by the year 2022. So, under this program, it has been planned to build around 2.95 crore houses by the year 2022. And the nationwide target for this financial year, that is financial year 2019-20, is 60 lakh houses. Now, let us see some of the salient features of this particular scheme. The beneficiaries of this scheme are identified based on the socio-economic caste census of 2011. Next, let us see the financial benefits that the state governments would give to the beneficiaries. For those who are living in the plain areas, they'd be given 1.2 lakh, and those who are living in hilly areas and backward districts will be given 1.3 lakh in order to build a pakka house with a hygienic kitchen space under the integrated action plan. Now, if you see, the cost which is shared between the center and the states is in the ratio of 60:40 in the plain areas, and it will be 90:10 in the northeastern and Himalayan states. When we tell 60:40, 60 will be shared by the center and 40 by the states, and 90:10, 90 by the center and 10 by the state. The next salient feature is that the progress with regards to construction of houses would be inspected by geotag photographs of the houses which are under construction. Then there is also a provision to construct toilets in association with Swachh Bharat Mission Gramin. So this is also one of the salient features of this mission. Next, the program envisages or it plans for pan-India training and certification of rural masons. Masons are those persons who help in building the houses. So they will invest in the training and certification of the rural mason so that their workmanship and the skill, the work skill, will improve by giving training and certification. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. The first question is, consider the following statements regarding International Seabed Authority, and they have given you two statements and have asked you to choose the correct answer. Let us see the first statement. The first statement tells that the International Seabed Authority was established under the 1982 United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, in short UN clause. This statement is correct. The second statement tells that it regulates the exploration and exploitation of marine living and non-living resources of oceans in international waters. Now, this statement is wrong. Know that International Seabed Authority regulates the exploration and exploitation of marine non-living resources. It is not the living resources. So, just have a note at this statement. So, the second statement is wrong here. It has asked you to choose the correct answer. So, here the first statement is only correct. So, the correct answer is option A, one only. Moving on to the second question. The question is, consider the following statements about canine distemper virus, and they have given you three statements and I have asked you to choose the correct answer. The first statement tells that canine distemper virus attacks respiratory and gastrointestinal parts of dogs. This statement is correct. The second statement tells that the infection can spread through air. Know that canine distemper virus can be spread through direct contact or indirect contact. The primary method of getting infection is by inhaling the virus, that is, it spreads through air, and one can get infected by the virus when it spreads through air. So the second statement is also correct. Moving on to the third statement. It tells that canine distemper virus has resulted in the death of lions in Gir forests in the year 2018. This statement is also correct. We saw this fact during our news analysis. Now the question has asked you to choose the correct answer. Since all the statements are correct, the correct answer is option C, 1, 2 and 3. Moving on to the next question, consider the following statements regarding genome sequencing. They have given you three statements and have asked you to choose the correct answer. The first statement is genome sequencing is figuring out the order of DNA nucleotides or bases in a genome. The statement is correct. Know that it is about figuring out the order of DNA nucleotides or bases in a genome. That is the order of adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine. So all these make up an organism's DNA. Moving on to the second statement, it tells that the Genome India Initiative aims at sequencing the diverse Indian genomes. This statement is correct. So this Genome India Initiative program will come under the Department of Biotechnology. So they have planned to scan nearly 20,000 Indian genomes. So this will help in capturing the biological diversity of India. And we saw that this program has been planned over 5 years in two phases. So the second statement is correct here. Moving on to the third statement, it tells that genome sequencing will help to study cancer risk. So under this project, they're expecting to develop diagnostic tests that can be used for cancer. So this statement is also correct. The question has asked you to choose the correct answer. Here the correct answer is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Moving on to the next question, consider the following statements regarding Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin. And they've given you three statements and I've asked you to choose the correct answer. The first statement is the beneficiaries are identified from the socio-economic caste census of 2011. This statement is correct. The second statement tells that the cost is shared between the center and the states in the ratio of 60:40 in the plain areas and 90:10 in the northeastern and Himalayan states. During our discussion, we also saw this fact. The second statement is also correct. Now let us see the third statement. It tells that this Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin is implemented by Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. This statement is wrong. We saw that this program is implemented by the Ministry of Rural Development. Now the question has asked you to choose the correct answer. The correct answer is option B, 1 and 2. Moving on to the next question, consider the following statements. The first statement tells that the strength of the judges of the Supreme Court can be modified by amending the Constitution of India. Now this statement is wrong. We saw that the strength of the judges of the Supreme Court are amending the Supreme Court Strength of Judges Act of 1956. Now this act has been enacted by the Parliament based on one of the provisions of the Indian Constitution, which is the article number 124. Now article 124 clause 1 tells that there shall be a Supreme Court of India constituting of a Chief Justice of India, and until Parliament by law prescribes a large number of not more than 7 other judges. So in the original constitution under article 124, it has provided for a Supreme Court of India which shall constitute a Chief Justice of India plus 7 other judges, and it has also told that until Parliament by law prescribes a larger number. So in order to increase the strength of the judges, the Parliament has enacted this, the Supreme Court Strength of Judges Act of 1956. So the first statement is wrong here. So know that it can be modified by amending the act, not the Constitution of India. Moving on to the second statement, the question tells that present strength of judges in the Supreme Court is 34 including the Chief Justice of India. It is wrong. The present strength of the judges in the Supreme Court including the Chief Justice of India is 31. The news is that the cabinet has approved for increasing the strength of the Supreme Court judges. So know that it is only under the approval of the cabinet. Now after this, the bill will be introduced in both the houses of the Parliament, and it has to be passed in both the houses of the Parliament, and then again it will go to the President for his assent. Once the President gives assent, it will become an act, and then the strength of the judges in the Supreme Court can be increased. So there is still a long process to go. The news is that only cabinet has given approval for increasing the strength of the judges. So this statement is also wrong. Now the question has asked you to choose the correct statements. Since both the statements are wrong, the correct answer is option D, neither 1 nor 2.
With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.